educational researchers have known for quite some time that there are very large educational and life opportunity gaps between children who are growing up in poverty and children from higher income backgrounds. While this work has all been critical, it's also important to recognize that studies have largely concentrated on documenting opportunities in one setting, whether that be at home or at school or elsewhere. And these studies have largely focused on one particular time or stage of development, such as looking at early childhood, or looking at middle childhood, or looking at opportunities in adolescence. Until now, what we've not had are studies documenting the accumulation of opportunity for individual children across early childhood, middle childhood, and adolescence in each of these key learning contexts, like the home, childcare, school, classroom, and community. Which means that until now, we did not have studies telling us precisely how large in total are cumulative opportunity gaps. That is, how many more opportunities are children from high-income backgrounds getting compared to children growing up in poverty? We haven't known how things have accumulated across their lives between children from advantaged and disadvantaged backgrounds. And it was this very question that my colleagues and I were interested in answering. To do so, we used a 26-year longitudinal study of over 800 children from around the U.S., tracking the number of educational and life opportunities that accrued between birth and the end of high school for children born into either low-income, middle-income, or higher-income households. What we found was that while children who were born into middle and higher-income homes generally accrued many opportunities to thrive, those born into lower-income backgrounds had many fewer opportunities. In fact, most had either only one or even, in many cases, none of the opportunities that we were assessing. And we found that the number of opportunities children experienced was strongly predictive of their level of educational attainment and their salaries at age 26, with the opportunity gaps largely helping explain why children from lower income backgrounds had lower levels of attainment and earnings. We also had evidence pointing toward the importance of improving opportunity for disadvantaged children. Each additional opportunity was most strongly and positively associated with education and earnings in adulthood for those children who had been born into lower income households. For example, for children from low income backgrounds, an increase from no opportunities to just four opportunities was associated with increasing the likelihood of graduating from a four-year college from about 10% to about 50%. So 1 in 10 children to 5 in 10 children, very large increase. But what kind of policies can accomplish this level of change? As my colleagues and I discussed in the paper, we will need policy solutions that open opportunities across systems, contexts, and across development. Now, it's important to remember that our results are entirely descriptive and correlational. Even so, our study provides novel evidence of very large cumulative opportunity gaps and robust evidence that these inequities in access to opportunities that cut across systems, contexts, and children's lives could be the key driver of disparities in life outcomes for children from lower and higher income households.